has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. He has done great things. He has done great things. Oh, hero of heaven, you conquered the grave. You free every captive and break every chain. Oh, God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awakened alive. Oh, Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high. Oh, God, you have done great things. Be faithful forevermore. You have done great things, and I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You will do great things. God, you do great things.
Hi everyone.
Paz de Cristo a todos. Me siento muy contenta porque hasta aquí Dios no nos ha dejado y les quiero decir que los extraño mucho y que el Señor los va a sacar adelante en todo esto que estamos pasando. Para Él no es imposible. Y nomás voy a leer un verso de la Biblia que dice, está en el Salmo 67:1, que dice: Dios tenga misericordia de nosotros y nos bendiga. Haga resplandecer su rostro sobre nosotros. Dios los bendiga a todos, hermanos. Los extrañamos y los amamos en el nombre de Jesucristo.
Bye, everyone.
Hi, Grace City. Wanted to say hi and I hope you guys are doing okay. We all miss you. The boys can't wait to get back into their Sunday classes, and we all can't wait for things to get back to normal. Hope you guys are all staying safe at home, and God bless you. Bye.
morning, everybody, and welcome to our online service. Buenos días a todos y bienvenidos a nuestro servicio en línea. We're just so happy that you've decided to join in on us on this beautiful Sunday morning. Estamos tan felices y contentos que ha decidido acompañarnos en este día. You know, the psalmist David said, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. And we have the unique opportunity where that place of worship is literally our home in this season that we're living in. And it's so wonderful to know that the presence of God inhabits the willing heart. The presence of God comes to a place where people are seeking Him. And I know we miss being in church and we miss the routine that we were used to, but there is something special about seeking God on your own, in your own time, around your loved ones, around your family, and inviting Him to come in to speak into your life and to grow. El salmista David dijo que yo me alegré cuando me decían a la casa de Jehová iremos. Y es algo tan especial que tenemos la oportunidad de hacer ese lugar de adoración nuestro hogar. Cada domingo con nuestra familia, invitar la presencia de Dios que venga y que hable nuestro corazón. I want to give you just a little short word of encouragement. You know, I know right now there's a lot of stuff happening and worry can come into your life and frustration can come into your life and irritability can come into your life and uncertainty can come into your life. Yo sé que ahorita estamos viviendo donde muchas emociones pueden entrar a nuestra vida. But I want you to understand that God is good, God is real, God is in control, God is aware of what's going on in your life, and you are not abandoned. I am not abandoned. The church isn't abandoned. God is with us, God is for us. And the Bible says that he who began a good work in your life will accomplish it to the day of Jesus Christ. In other words, he started whatever's going on in your life, and he's gonna finish it. Whatever dreams, whatever aspirations, whatever callings, whatever motivation you had towards God before this pandemic, before this crisis, I want you to believe that God is still working on that. God is still moving that forward. God will bring you out of this storm. La Biblia dice que el que comenzó la buena obra en nosotros la terminará hasta el día de Jesucristo. Es decir que no importa lo que estemos pasando ahorita, no importa las emociones, quiero que tengamos fe en este día. Le quiero animar a refugiarnos en la palabra que nos dice que Dios va a estar con nosotros cada paso de nuestra vida, cada tormenta, Él va a estar ahí. Y aunque se sienta como que algo no está pasando y entre la frustración, le quiero recordar, hay que refugiarnos en la paz, en la certidumbre que tenemos que Cristo es nuestra roca. Christ is our rock. Okay, so hang in there. Here are a few things that I think you can do right now during this season. Aquí hay unas cosas que creo que usted puede hacer durante esta temporada. Right now, it's a perfect opportunity to get into the Word of God. Right now in your home, in your routine, you can allot time, set some time aside, pick up the Bible reading plan that the church has on the app, on social media, join in on the Bible reading that we're doing. Read a chapter a day, a verse a day, a couple chapters a day, and start feeding yourself the Word of God. You know, we believe the Word of God is inspired. It speaks to our life. This is something that you can do that can help dispel fear, anxiety, worry. Le recomiendo en estos días refugiarnos en la Palabra de Dios. Adoptemos el plan que tiene la iglesia o abramos la Biblia de nuestra voluntad y escojamos una porción de Escritura para poder quitar la ansiedad, la preocupación. Empecemos a alimentarnos. Si no lo ha hecho, empiece a alimentarse con la Palabra de Dios. Another thing I recommend you to do during this time is get into worship music. You know, if you don't have a big worship library in your life, the church has a playlist on Spotify that we recommend a few songs, if you don't have them already, where you can just enjoy and worship. And again, this is a perfect time where you can lift up your faith and sing songs of victory, sing songs of praise, sing songs that put the right perspective over your life. Este es un buen tiempo para refugiarnos en música de adoración, de alabanza y adoración. Si no tiene música que escuchar, la iglesia tiene un playlist de música en el app de Spotify que lo puede conseguir por las redes sociales. Es una buena oportunidad para exaltar a Dios, cantar cantos de alabanza, cantos de adoración y empezar a levantar nuestro espíritu y levantar nuestra fe. Another thing I'd like to recommend you to do during this time is hit up a friend, you know, call somebody. Call somebody that you know in the church, call a family member, look out for your neighbors, look out for people that you know that may be in need. Call a brother from the church, a sister from the church, encourage one another in the faith. You know, ask how their day is going. If you haven't realized it or not, we're people that we abide with community. We need one another. We need that phone call. We need to hear the voice of our loved ones. We need to be with one another. So do your best and use the social means. Set up a Zoom meeting with somebody. Set up a FaceTime meeting with somebody. And talk to somebody. Talk to your friends. Work on that friendship, that relationship that you have. Yo le animo durante ese tiempo que haga lo posible para estar en comunión con alguien. Alguien de la iglesia, un hermano, una hermana, hablarle, darle una palabra de ánimo, buscar la amistad de alguien, procurar el bien de los que están en nuestra vida, a nuestro alrededor, y seguir siendo una familia en comunidad. Again, I want to just give you a few tips to help us weather this storm. Nomás son algunas diferentes ideas para ayudarnos a pasar bien este tiempo que estamos en casa. Let's use it as an opportunity, you know, spend time with the family, spend time with the kids, you know, try to catch up on things that we haven't done in a while, but enjoy the time that we have with the Lord and remember that God is with us, that we are not abandoned, God is in control of our life. Dios está con nosotros, no somos abandonados. If you're joining us for the first time, maybe somebody recommended this service for you, we ask you to just wave hi, we ask you to keep on keeping on in this spiritual journey that you're in with the Lord. God loves you and God wants to do something powerful in your life. At this moment, we're going to invite you to open up your app, the church app. We're going to get into the Word of God. Le voy a invitar que por qué no abra su aplicación en su teléfono, busque el bosquejo, go under sermon notes. The sermon for today is now more than ever. Pull it up and you'll have an outline there of all the bullet points that we're going to be expressing. All the scriptures are already outlined for you. Puede levantar el sermón por ahora. Se llama Ahora Más Que Nunca. Y puede seguir el bosquejo ahí. Están las escrituras, están los puntos, los incisos que vamos a platicar en este día. And look, I'm going to ask you, why don't you say amen, clap your hands, rejoice, participate in the chat, and let us know that you're there. Let the church know that you're there. And let's do our best to be receptive of the word. Go ahead and turn with me to 2 Timothy 4, verse 1 through 5. This is Paul writing to Timothy. You can follow me on your app. The title is Now More Than Ever. El título es Ahora Más Que Nunca. It reads like this. I solemnly urge you in the presence of God and Jesus Christ, who will someday judge the living and the dead, when he comes to set up his kingdom, that you preach the word of God. Be prepared whether the time is favorable or not. Amen. Let's pray. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Lord Jesus, right now, in this moment, bless everyone, God, that's joining in, that's watching, Lord, that's listening, that's gathering, God. Speak to us, God, a word that'll correct, a word that'll encourage and motivate and get us closer to your presence, God. This is a supernatural thing we're doing, Father. Right now, do the impossible in our life. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. How big of an impact do you think God can do with you right now, in this hour, for this season? I think that was a question that maybe Timothy was juggling with or was coming to terms with. And the Apostle Paul writes these verses to encourage him, to motivate him, that he can be used for this hour to make a significant impact, to change the course of history in the lives of many people and of his culture around him. Yo creo que Timoteo estaba luchando con la pregunta quizás de ¿Qué tanta diferencia puedo hacer yo en mi vida ahora, en este momento, en este día? Y creo que los versículos que Pablo escribe son una admonestación para afirmar en él que sí puede hacer un impacto tremendo, puede cambiar el curso, la trayección de la vida de muchos en su comunidad. And I want you and I to have that same encouragement this morning. I want you to finish this sermon believing that you can make a significant difference in your world today, in your family, with your loved ones, in your community, in your neighborhood, in your workplace. God can use you to change people. God can use you to help people. God can use you to lift up His name, and His name receive all glory. And He will be with you every step of the way. Dios lo puede usar a usted en este día, en esta época, en esta temporada, en este tiempo, para hacer una diferencia tremenda. Y ese es el gol del mensaje en esta mañana. He tells Timothy three things. The first thing he tells him, I urge you, I strongly urge you before the presence of God, Timothy, that you preach the word. Te animo mucho delante de la presencia de Dios que prediques la palabra. That's point number one, that you preach the word. Whether the time is favorable or not, he tells Timothy. Whether there's a crisis going on outside, whether people are running around in hysteria, whether people are stressed, whether people are experiencing poverty, sickness, depression, happiness, I want you, Timothy, to be consistent and you preach the word. Make the word known. Publish it, announce it. Predica la palabra. Si el tiempo es oportuno o no, si las cosas afuera son favorables o no, si la gente está en enfermedad o sanidad, en gozo o en tristeza, en preocupación o estabilidad, tú predica la palabra que todavía salva. This word, Timothy, is still alive, it's still relevant, it's still significant. And you and I need to have that same concept to continue preaching and making known and declaring the word of God. La palabra de Dios sigue siendo viva, sigue siendo eficaz, sigue siendo relevante para nuestro tiempo. Y ahora más que nunca, necesitamos que predicar la palabra de Dios. Now more than ever, we must preach the word of God. That's the best way where you and I are going to make a difference. Because the word of God is still powerful enough to rescue a person that is bound to sin. The word of God is still powerful enough to change and restore marriages that are on the rocks. The word of God is still powerful enough to heal somebody from anger, from racism, from resentment towards a loved one. The word of God is still powerful enough to liberate the unbelieving mind and to bring in faith inside of someone who thought they couldn't believe. La palabra de Dios todavía es poderosa para salvar al pecador, para restaurar relaciones quebrantadas, para traer paz y traer fe en un corazón que era incrédulo. La palabra de Dios ahora se ocupa más que nunca. We need this now more than ever. We need a good echo of the word of God. Preach the word of God that states that God is love. Predica la palabra de Dios que dice que Dios es amor. That at his core is love. When he tells Timothy to preach the word of God, he's telling him, go tell people that God is love. That God is for them. He's not against them. Go tell people. Don't tell them religion. Don't preach to them boundaries and division and walls and separation and liturgy and vestments and traditions. Don't preach to them all that stuff that places people. Preach to them the love. Predícales el amor. No tanto la religión, las vestiduras, no tanto la ley, no tanto denominaciones, reglas, separaciones, muros. Predícales el Dios de amor. That God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever had faith to believe would not die but have everlasting life. Predícales que de tal manera amó Dios al mundo que dio su Hijo unigénito para que todos los que crean en Él no se pierdan, mas tengan vida eterna. Tell them that love. Man, I think we need that in our world today. We need a voice, a fresh voice from you and I that is still telling people, hey, the message of the cross is relevant. My God is a God of love. He is not here to separate himself from you. He is here because he loves you, and he is here to bring you to him. The Bible tells us in Romans 5:8 that this is how God demonstrated his love for us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. Así demostró Dios el amor por nosotros, que mientras aún siendo pecadores, Cristo murió por los impíos. When we were at our worst, God died for us because he's love. When nobody else wanted us, God died for us. When everybody thought that we had nothing left to offer, God saw something valuable in us. We need to preach the word that God is love. So many people always think that God is against them, that God is not for them. But the Bible says in 1 Peter 3:18 that Christ died for sins once, the just for the unjust. The undeserving died for the people deserving of death so that he can bring us to God. The whole point of God's love is to have a vibrant, living relationship with you and I. El gol, la meta del amor de Dios es para llevarnos a Dios, según Pedro. Es llevarnos a Dios. El justo por los injustos murió para llevarnos a Dios, crear una relación. La gente necesita escuchar esto de parte de Dios. You know, they always put God on trial. Why would God allow this? Why is God doing this? Why did God allow them to suffer? Why is God doing this? And right now we need a refreshing voice in our community that still announces to people, hey, look, God is love. And God doesn't hate you. And God is not fighting you. God at his core, he's love. He wants you to be saved. He wants you to come to new life. He wants you to live the abundant life. The Bible says that the enemy comes to kill, steal, and destroy. But Jesus said, I have come that you will have life and have it in abundance. It's God's goal for you to live an abundant life in every area of your life. That's the word that we need to be preaching. Jesús dijo, el enemigo viene para matar, hurtar y destruir. Mas yo, Cristo dice, he venido para traernos vida y vida en abundancia. La gente necesita que saber que Dios es un Dios de amor que desea la vida abundante. Preach to them the word that states that God will not tolerate sin. That God hates sin and he will not tolerate it. Predica a Timoteo la palabra que dice que Dios odia el pecado y no tolerará el pecado en su vida. Yes, we need to announce that God is love. I believe that 100%. God loves me. God loves you. But one thing that we need to tell people, we're talking about, look, do you think you can make a difference in this season right now with everything that's going on around us? And what I'm saying is that Paul is telling Timothy all this to convince him that, yes, he can. And to do that, you and I need to preach the word. And we need to tell people that God is love. But we need to also tell people that he hates sin and he will not tolerate it. I know that everybody loves to hear that, hey, you're not so bad. You're doing things good. You're all right. You know, don't beat yourself up. There's room. No. We need to preach the word that says God did not die for the consequence of my sin so that I can enjoy to live in my sin. No. That would be unappreciating and laughing at the cross of Christ. Dios no murió en la cruz por la paga de mis pecados para que yo viva mi vida gozando de mis pecados. No, eso sería mal aprecio. Eso sería burlarse de la cruz de Jesús. No, el mundo necesita que saber. La comunidad, si queremos hacer una diferencia, necesitamos que anunciar la palabra que dice Dios odia el pecado y él no va a tolerar el pecado. He will not tolerate sin. Man, there are so many people, church, that are out there misinformed because some spiritual leader, because some mentor told him that it's okay, there's room for you, there's grace for you, there's acceptance for you in that condition. And sure, when we come to Christ, we come as sinners. I mean, we're still sinners right now, but there is a fear of God that leads us to a daily repentance, that we are not practicing habitual sins. No, no, no. We are trying to walk in the newness of life, right? That's what the Bible says. We need to tell people. We need to teach people. If you're questioning, can you make a difference in your life right now? Yes, you can, by doing this right now. The world needs to know. Our community needs to know. El mundo necesita que saber. Nuestra comunidad necesita que saber. Look, we need to know. Psalms 5:4. Oh God, you take no pleasure in wickedness. You cannot tolerate the sins of the wicked. You cannot. It is impossible for God to tolerate sin. Because he's holy. Porque él es santo. Salmo nos dice que él no puede tolerar estar en la habitación, morar con el pecado. He cannot. The Bible says the consequence of sin is death. God cannot tolerate it. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ. We need to preach that message. People need to know. It's not how tradition has presented the concept of God. How life is like an etch-a-sketch and you just start over and start over and start. No, it's not like that. He will not tolerate these sins that he died on the cross for in my life. And I need to live in freedom, right? Look at what 1 Corinthians 6:9 says. Mire lo que 1 Corinthians 6:9. It says, don't you realize that those who do wrong will not inherit the kingdom of God? Now, he's addressing saved believers here, okay? Don't fool yourselves. Those who indulge in sexual sin or who worship idols or who commit adultery or are male prostitutes or practice homosexuality or are thieves or greedy people or drunkards or abusive or cheap people, none of these will inherit the kingdom of God. We're talking about a holy God that died for the sins that I just described. And he's saying these habitual sinners of these things will not inherit the kingdom of God. We need to tell our community with love because we want to help. We want to make a difference. We need to tell them the full counsel and say, hey, look, God will not tolerate this sin in your life. He wants you to have freedom. And church, I share with you today this word with so much love and so much desire for all of us to walk in the freedom that God has for us. It is not, we cannot fool ourselves. We cannot fool ourselves and think that, oh, believing God is a patriotic thing to do, and being a Christian and having a cross and having the Not of This World sticker is the patriotic thing to do, is the acceptable thing to do. No, we're talking about a real God that has a real plan for your life, that wants to use you to make a difference today in this world, that wants you to experience a life of freedom. That's why he resurrected from the grave, so that you won't be bound to sin anymore. And you and I, we need to walk in this new life and tell other people, hey, look, preach the word of God. Like he told Timothy, whether the time is favorable or not, with whatever's going on around, people need to be saved. People need to hear the full counsel of the word of God. We can't afford to gamble with our life. Come on, we're going through a season right now where we're spending a lot of time, you know, on our own, at home, with family, evaluating self, evaluating our relationship with the Lord. Let's not let this time pass us by with us not drawing closer to God. Let's not let this time pass us by without us not addressing these issues with God and experiencing a full freedom that we have with the Lord. No. Los pecados de 1 Corintios 6, 9 al 10, Dios no los va a tolerar, ¿verdad? El que practica pecado sexual, el que es idólatra, el que comete adulterio, los afeminados, los rateros, los que tienen avaricia, los borrachos, los abusivos, no van a heredar el reino de Dios. Y nosotros sí tenemos que predicar un Dios de amor. We have to preach a love of God. I am all for that. Pero también tenemos que predicar el mensaje que Dios no va a tolerar el pecado. God will not tolerate sin. We need to share that part as well. He goes on to tell Timothy, preach the word of God, right? And the word of God that is in your hands, Timothy. Predica la palabra de Dios que está en tus manos. He wrote to the Corinthians. And all of this is a gift from God who brought us back to himself through Christ and has given us, has left in our hands, the word of reconciliation, the task of reconciliation. In other words, Timothy, look, preach the word of God that is left in your hands. I wonder if you think about the word of God that way. When you became a believer, I wonder if you think that you were given the word of God as a treasure and it's been left in your hands. And it's up to you to make it known, to share it, to tell people. I'm not talking about going on the street corner, getting a megaphone and blasting the message. If you do, you know, praise God. Amen. I'm sure you're going to have some fruit. I'm not knocking that. But I'm talking about on your daily living, just sharing the good news and telling people the happiness that you have with God, the peace that Christ gives you during this pandemic, the joy that you have in the Holy Spirit because of your relationship with God. That is a voice that's refreshing. That is a voice that brings life, that brings vision. And that is left in your hands. That word of God was left in your hands. You're not the end. You're the beginning. When God comes into your life, he's going to reach so many people through you. I'm telling you right now, Timothy was probably wondering, how much of a difference can I make? And Paul wants to dial it in and he wants to tell him, look, Timothy, preach the word of God and you're going to make a world of a difference in the lives of people. Preach the sound doctrine. Tell them that I'm loved. Tell them that I came to give them freedom and tell them that I'm going to use them. Tell them that I got a plan for their life. God has a plan for you. God wants to use you today, right now, in this season, to bring life, to make a difference. Now more than ever, we need you to understand this message. Ahora más que nunca, es tiempo de realizar que la palabra está en mis manos. Y la historia no termina conmigo, empieza conmigo. De aquí va a ser enunciado el evangelio a aquellos que están alrededor en mi vida. Yo voy a recibir esta palabra de reconciliación para ser de bendición en mi trabajo, en mi vecindad, en mi familia, en mi vida. Amen. You're not the end, you're the beginning. He goes on to tell Timothy, preach the word, Timothy, patiently correct, rebuke, exhort your people with good teaching. Con paciencia, Timoteo, corrige, reprende y exhorta a tu gente con buena enseñanza. Point number two, commit to causing a positive change. Punto número dos, comprométete a causar un cambio positivo. Now more than ever, commit to causing a positive change. Now more than ever. This is what we need. If you're doubting, Timothy, if you're going to make a difference in your world, if you're doubting right now, if you can make a difference right now in your life, commit to causing a positive change. Yes, you can. You can make a difference. You can be used by God. This group of people that are in your life that God has given you favor, este grupo de gente que está en su vida que Dios le ha dado favor, patiently work with them. Patiently commit to them. Patiently, with long suffering, correct, rebuke, exhort. Disciple them. Don't abandon them. Don't run out on them. I think sometimes the church is so quick again to say, this is wrong, that is wrong, change this, don't do this, fix that, get this right in your life, and then we leave. And now more than ever, we need believers to stay. We need believers to rise up. We need believers to not quit. We need believers to say, look, God gave me this job for a reason. I'm going to commit to causing a positive change. I'm going to commit to discipling. En veces la iglesia es pronta para anunciar, cambia esto, deja esto, termina con esto, no hables así, no hagas eso, no hagas lo otro, pero en veces nos vamos. Y Pablo le está diciendo a Timoteo, con paciencia, sufre y aguanta que tienes que corregir, que tienes que reprender, que tienes que exhortar con buena enseñanza a este pueblo que está en tus manos, a tu vecindad, a tu familia, a tus amigos. A las personas que estás compartiendo el evangelio, comprométete a causar un cambio positivo. Don't quit on them. Don't quit on them. Don't run out. Don't abandon them. Commit. Stay for their change. Because look at what's going to happen. For a time is coming when people will no longer listen to sound, wholesome teaching. They will follow their own desires. They will look for teachers that will tell them whatever their itching ears want to hear. They will reject the truth and they will chase after myths. No los abandones, Timoteo, porque va a llegar el tiempo cuando ellos te van a abandonar. La gente no va a escuchar la buena doctrina. La gente va a buscarse maestros que les van a decir lo que sus oídos quieren escuchar. Ellos van a estar siguiendo las fábulas, las cosas falsas. Por eso, comprométete con paciencia. Con paciencia, discipula este grupo. Now more than ever, you and I need to commit to being Christians that are working, that are serving. Because this, what Paul is saying, is not an if. It's a when. It's a reality. People will leave a false gospel, or I'm sorry, people will leave the true gospel to a false gospel. They will find teachers, they will find the teachers, and they will have the teachers teach them whatever they want to hear. That's scary. That's a dangerous time we're living in. Because the enemy is going to leverage spiritual leaders that are willing to teach tolerance, that are willing to teach that you can masquerade sin with interpretation, that are willing that you can masquerade sin and cover up sin and present it with cultural adaptation, with cultural relevance. You can masquerade sin under sophisticated prejudice, sophisticated racism. I mean, I'm talking about leaders out there that are teaching you that, oh, it's okay. Just, you know, don't go too far. You know, don't have too much because then it's sin. So just keep an eye on it and everything with moderation. That doesn't even make sense. How can you have a little bit of sin and be okay but not a lot of sin? That doesn't even make sense. We need to now more than ever to make a difference in our world. Be a voice of the true gospel. Be a voice to our family of the true gospel. Look, people will leave the truth and they will find teachers that will just tell them what they want to hear. But now more than ever, like Paul admonishes Timothy, I encourage us in the fear of the Lord that now more than ever, we need to be people that are speaking the sound doctrine. We need to be people that are announcing the goodness of God, yes. Announcing the love of God, yes. Announcing that God is for believers, yes. But also teaching, hey, now that you're saved, you got to leave that. Now that you're saved, you need to change that. Now that God is in your life and you're building faith and you're confessing Christ in your life, you want to get closer to the Lord. Okay, it's time to part with this. It's time to part with that because you want to make it. Come on, it says, don't be fooled. We don't have time to gamble. And in our community right now, we're all concerned and we're staying safe of the coronavirus. And praise God, we all need to take the precautions necessary. But there is another thing out there, another plague that has taken over people, and that's the plague of sin. And now more than ever, it doesn't matter what the virus out there or not, the message is relevant. Now more than ever, we need to be consistent and preach the word. We need to share that God is love, that he wouldn't tolerate sin. We need to share it, that God is going to use you, that he's going to use me. We need to commit to a group of people, commit to our community, commit to the friends that we're witnessing to, commit to our husband, to our wife, to our children that we're raising up in the Lord. We need to commit to the souls that we're sharing the gospel to. And we need to say, hey, look, there will be teachers. And it's not about what's convenient and comfortable for you. No, it's about what's going to honor God. Ahora más que nunca, tenemos que anunciar el evangelio porque sí es cierto está el virus afuera afectando personas, pero hay otra plaga mayor y esa es la plaga del pecado que todavía necesitamos una palabra que es relevante para salvación para las personas. Amen. He goes on to tell Timothy, 2 Timothy 4:5, but you should keep a clear mind in every situation, Timothy. Don't be afraid of suffering for the Lord. Work at telling others the good news and fully carry out the ministry that God has given you. He says, keep a clear mind. You want to make a difference, Timothy. You want to be used. You want to be effective. Keep a clear mind. You need to be sound. You got to be, have your ear to heaven and have your ear to earth. Have your ear to heaven to hear and have your ear to be able to know what the needs are, relay them back, get the message, give it back to the people. You got to have your ear on both, but you got to have your mind focused. You got to keep your mind clear. Don't contaminate yourself with the media. Don't contaminate yourself with the hysteria. Don't contaminate yourself with the things that people are chasing after, toys and cars and possessions and riches and investments. Don't get so caught up with that. Keep a clear mind. Don't be afraid of suffering for the Lord and do your part. Point number three, don't lose your focus. Do your part. Punto número, le dice a Timoteo, en el versículo 5, mantén tu mente clara en cada situación. No te contamines. No te distraigas. No pierdas el enfoque. Mantén tu mente clara en cada situación. Y haz obra de evangelista. Cumple tu ministerio. Enfócate. Punto número 3 es, no pierdas tu enfoque. Haz de tu parte. Now, more than ever, keep a clear mind. Watch out with what's going on. You got children behind you. You got a spouse behind you. You got people in your life that look up to you. You got people in your life that depend on you. Make a difference right now in this season. Be level-headed. Keep a clear mind. Keep a godly perspective, a faith perspective. The Bible says, the just shall live by faith. Live a lifestyle of faith. Not of the things which are seen, but the things which are unseen. Have your mind in heaven often. Interpret life that way. Keep your clear mind. Mantén tu mente clara. Ahora más que nunca. Now more than ever, keep your focus and do your part. That's what you and I need. Now more than ever, we need to be believers that realize that we have a focus, and our focus is to honor God, to help others while we're here, to serve people, to do our part. I mean, look, I believe that you're gifted. I believe the gospel came into your life for a reason. I believe that you, if you've received the Holy Spirit in your life, the Holy Spirit comes with supernatural gifts, with anointings. I believe that God is going to use all the pieces of your life for His good. And that's exciting to see. And now more than ever, there are people that need hope. Now more than ever, there are people that need to hear that the Word of God is still relevant. People that need peace in the middle of this pandemic. That need joy in the middle of this pandemic. Right now, there are so many people turning to the Lord right now. And I'm concerned that many of them are starting to come to the Lord, but they don't have a group of people that are discipling them. They don't have friends and family that are committed to their positive change. Ahora gente está llegando al Evangelio. Muchos están abriendo. Y gloria a Dios, pero mi pendiente es que no tienen un grupo que está comprometido al cambio con ellos. Que está ahí para enseñar, para reprender, para corregir, para estimular. Amén. Ocupamos nosotros ser este tipo de gente. Esta iglesia que está constante en predicar, que está constante en comprometernos a ayudarles, a discipular, y que estamos constantes en nuestro enfoque y hacer nuestra parte. Right? I want to encourage you to that. Let's have that be our goal in this season right now, to say, God, you know what? I want you to use my life. I want, Lord Jesus, to always make your word known. I want, Lord Jesus, to commit to a group of people, to not abandon. I want to be there, consistent, readily available. I want to do my part in the kingdom. And look, you know what was so wonderful about all this, what I love about Paul? The context of the admonishment he gave to Timothy. Me encanta el contexto que tenía Pablo de esta admonestación que le da a Timoteo. Me encanta. He says, I strongly urge you before the presence of God and Jesus, who will one day judge all living and all dead when he comes to establish his kingdom. I love that. Because Paul is saying, I'm giving you these things, Timothy, because there's a God that's coming. There's a God that's coming and he's going to judge everyone. And I want them to make it. I want them to be saved. Dice Timoteo, te doy esto con mucha amonestación en presencia de Dios y Cristo, quien va a venir y va a juzgar. cuando venga a establecer su reino a todos los vivos, a todos los muertos. Este es mi contexto. Por eso es necesario ser constante, porque viene un juicio. That's why it's necessary to be consistent as a believer. Don't fluctuate. Don't toss like the waves. Let's be consistent. Let's be used. Let's go out there and give people hope and teach the full counsel of God. Let's go out there and bring people to the cross, right? Let's go out there and be focused and do our part, reach our family and pray for our friends, and let's be used by God. Let's make a difference, because Christ is coming back. There's a judgment that awaits this world, and we need our community to be saved. We want them to live the life of abundance. Look, if you're listening to this sermon for the first time, this is your first time that you log on, or you're on here because a friend invited you, or whatever reason it may be, you're starting off in your journey. This is for you. This is what God wants for you. He wants you to be changed by the power of the gospel. He wants you to realize that you can be used in this hour for God's glory. Right now, you can be used to help people, because there's a judgment coming. Amen. I'm going to invite you to pray with me. Lord Jesus, we love you, God. And we thank you, God, for your word. Lord, let this word fall on good ground. That, Lord, we would be believers that would rise up and realize today is the hour. Now is the season, Father. And you have great plans, Lord, for us to use us now so that we can touch, so that we can reach people that are out there, that are in need, that are spiritually lost, Father. I want that. Use my life, Lord Jesus. Help me, Lord, be a blessing to people around me, Lord Jesus. Help me be focused and always do my part. In Jesus' name, Lord, bless the heart of every hearer that is gathered. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Hey, listen, I wanted to, before we leave, I wanted to just thank you once again for joining us for service. If this was your first time, we're so honored that you're with us. We want to bless you. We want to pray for you. If you don't have a church family, if you don't have a home, I want you to reach out to us. And why don't you comment right there on the discussion right there. Reach out to us. We want to bless you with a gift from our church. If you've never accepted Christ in your life, I want to invite you to make a prayer at home. Accept the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Reach out to us, because we want to help you on your spiritual journey. Si usted nos visita por primera vez, muchas gracias por estar con nosotros. Nuestro deseo es que Dios lo bendiga, que bendiga su vida. Si no conoce a Jesús y hoy se quiere entregar a Él, haga una oración de arrepentimiento en su casa con fe. Y mándenos un mensaje en este medio social, y nosotros vamos a ayudarle en su jornada espiritual, ¿ok? God bless you. You capture my attention, was lost so wild and free. You light my soul on fire.